All right, so welcome to the lecture on, well, weak Riemannian geometry, and in the framework of our course, so we are mostly interested in weak Riemannian geometry on manifolds of mappings, since we have been studying these manifolds of mappings, and we will see several ways of lifting, again, geometric properties from a finite dimensional manifold to an infinite dimensional one, namely to one of these manifolds of mappings. And anyway, so what I want to be showing to you is now the first chapter on weak and strong Riemannian metrics. And I assume that at least some of you have not seen yet the notion of a Riemannian metric. So let me just motivate. I mean, there are many ways why you could be interested in a Riemannian metric. Let me just show you one one motivation why we could be interested in this, and let me draw a finite dimensional picture. I mean, let's do something very, very simple. Let's say, I guess, calculus 2 or something like that. I mean, if we are in R2, we have and we have 2 points. Then it's almost proverbial that the distance between the 2 points is the length of the line segment between those. So if we have A and B, then if this thing here is not doing anything weird but just goes from A to B, then and we have this, let's say this is gamma of t, then the length of this gamma of t is just the, let's say, norm of A minus B, or B minus A, doesn't matter. What one learns then is, I mean, if I have a straight segment, that's relatively straightforward. But if I have something curved, but let's say differentiable, for this, eta of t, how do I compute the length of eta of t? So if I have a curved thing which is at least differentiable, then I just say, well, okay, I can take the derivative of the eta, I can take the norm of this guy, and then I integrate over it. Let's say eta is parameterized from 0 to 1, doesn't matter really, but I'm integrating over the derivative, and this gives me the length of the curve. Okay, and right, so this is all in R2 and everything is fine. So we learn this in basic calculus. Now, let's say we are on a manifold. Let's say we take this sphere here. So S2 inside of R3. And then we have a point here, let's say the North Pole. And we have another point somewhere on the sphere here. Call this guy again B. Then obviously, I mean, now I've embedded the whole thing, and if I would just calculate sort of the distance between those two things in Euclidean space, then I would still get distance in Euclidean space would then of course be just the norm of B minus N. But this is certainly not the distance I want to have on my sphere, right? Because as you can, what this short drawing should indicate is that the straight path between the two lines is leaving the sphere, so it's not staying on top of the sphere. And staying on top of the sphere, I would need to somehow connect it. Now I do this, let's do the sensible thing, which then turns out to be also the shortest connection. I would need to follow such an arc which lives on the surface of the sphere. And then, now in this embedded picture, we see that we get still something curved. And here in our embedded picture, we can of course use this calculation from above, where we calculated the length as the integral over the derivative. We could in principle also do this here, but The question is, of course, okay, I mean, here we are, if we are doing that to compute the integral of this, the derivatives of the curve, we're actually using this concrete embedding, at least in the way I'm writing it down now. And so this works if we have an embedding. At our disposal, where we can make sense. So the integral is not the problem at this point, because we're integrating over over a curve. So this would be just integrating over an interval. But the problem here, where we actually need the embedding, is the norm here, right? So if we have our embedded submanifold, then we can use the norm of the ambient space to do this. And the question is what to do on a manifold. Let's say without an ambient embedding. Obviously, this is a lot of a hassle. We don't want. I mean, with the sphere, it's nice, of course. We can realize this one just sitting inside of three-dimensional space, and we have this embedding. But usually, we don't want to be carrying this around. So, and the problem is, I mean, if I take just an arbitrary curve, let's say eta, from 0 to 1, which takes values in a manifold M. If I take eta dot, let's say at t. Then this is an element at the tangent space of M, and so this tangent space, this is isomorphic to the model space, and I can use this isomorphism to get a norm on the tangent space, but obviously my choice of norm then at least depends on the embedding or the isomorphism I have used. While in finite dimensions this is usually not a problem because all norms are equivalent, at least for the calculation it is a problem, because in the calculation, as you see here, we want the norm of we want to integrate over the norms, and if we can only determine this norm up to a constant, then obviously depending on the tangent space we are in, the constants may and will vary probably. So we are having all of these different norms, so this is not feasible to just say, oh, we can somehow norm it. We need actually an additional structure. To drive these computations. And this is the so-called Riemannian metric. And I wasn't giving you the whole story here, because we want two things. We want some choice of norm on each tangent space. And what we want is, on one hand, this choice should not just be arbitrary, so because otherwise these length calculations do not make sense. So the norm should somehow depend smoothly on the base point where we're at. So if we are changing this base point here, we want that the norm changes in a smooth way. And actually, for a lot of the geometric considerations here, let's say in R2 or in more generally in Euclidean space, we don't only want to have a norm, but we want to exploit often that the norm is here actually coming from an inner product. In the standard case, we have this inner product, and then we take the square root of this one, right? And so a Riemannian metric will not just be some smooth selection of norms on the tangent spaces, but a smooth selection of inner products on the tangent spaces, because inner products give us a lot more geometric information than if we would purely choose a norm. I mean, okay, so Riemannian metric, and this should basically correspond to a smooth choice of inner products on the tangent spaces. Okay, so this is what we want, but now before we before I define a Riemannian metric, let's dwell a short little while on what do you mean by smooth choice. So in Euclidean space, this the norm we have here in the calculation, so this norm doesn't change at all. Well, if it's not, if it's constant, then obviously it it's also smooth. However, what we are exploiting on Euclidean space, we are basically exploiting that on Euclidean space all tangent spaces are created equal, right? So we have this formula. If I take the tangent space, let's say of R2, then this is R2 times R2. So where this is the tangent component, and this is the base point. And there's nothing happening here. Whereas on a manifold, sort of the tangent spaces are all isomorphic. Well, if at least with the same connected component, but we don't get a nice presentation like this. So from the vector bundle perspective, we would say that this is a trivial vector bundle. Right, because we can write it as the base manifold. So this was the base manifold times a vector space. Well, okay, I mean the base manifold was in this case also a vector space, but it's a trivial bundle if whenever we can identify it, or whenever it's isomorphic to the base manifold times a vector space. Okay, so and this smooth choice here should somehow be formalized in the language of vector bundles. On vector spaces, we don't have a problem because then the tangent bundle of a vector space is trivial. But on a non-trivial manifold in general, so in general, we do not have that the tangent bundle of a manifold splits as M times E, let's say where E is a locally convex space, right? If we have such a global bundle, we can basically put an inner product here on the vector component, and could then be happy and say this is a smooth choice because it doesn't change. However, for so for the general one, we need a special vector bundle which helps us explain what we mean by smooth. And what do we need? So looking at this formula up here, where we have the norm and we have the inner product. So if we think of, let's say, x at some so this is inner product of x with x 1/2. And obviously we would like x and y. So we would like to be able to compute the inner product of these two things. And so here, the x and the y, they should be from the same tangent space. Okay, so we need a vector bundle which collects the product of tangent spaces with themselves. The smooth structure will then help to explain what we mean by smooth choice. Okay, so let's have a short look at how this is defined. We have already talked briefly about this in the context of vector bundles, so this is more of a repetition. So let's say we have two vector bundles over one manifold M, then we can form the product bundle, right? And the product bundle is the one which is just given by taking all fibers of the bundle, so E1, the fiber over M, times E2, the fiber over N, let's say, right? And so those are the typical fibers for, so and we collect for all M, N in M. And the product bundle is a bundle sitting over the direct product of M with itself. And we see that the product bundle is not quite what we want, because when we define these inner products, we want to be able to form the inner product of an element in a fiber of the tangent bundle with another element in the same fiber. And the product bundle basically collects all products of fibers, not just the products of a fiber with itself. Okay, so we need basically to refine our choice here. The product bundle is not what we can use. And so the bundle we are searching is the so-called Whitney sum of the bundle, and this is formed now again from, we can always form this for two vector bundles E1 and E2, and it's denoted E1 plus E2. This is now a bundle, so while the product bundle lives over M times M, the Whitney sum lives again over the same manifold we started with over M, and we define it as a pullback bundle. So this is the pullback bundle. For delta, and delta is the diagonal map, which sends M to, so M is getting sent to all the diagonal to a diagonal element M times M, right? And we have seen in the lecture on vector bundles, we have seen this construction of the pullback bundle. So this means that the Whitney sum is actually a smooth vector bundle if E1 and E2 are smooth vector bundles over M. And we get the nice property. So, I mean, what is the meaning of this? So we start with the product bundle E1 times E2, and we pull it back over the diagonal. So this actually means if I take E1 plus E2, so what is the fiber in the Whitney bundle at some point P? It turns out that is the fiber of E1 at P. Sorry, didn't want to use that one. Times the fiber of E2 over P, right? So the Whitney sum collects all products of fibers of the bundles with itself. Sorry, not with itself. The fiber of E1 over P with the times the fiber of E2 over P, and so note that that for the product bundle we have all sorts of, so we could here have a P, and on the other fiber we have a Q, but for the Whitney sum the P is always the same. So this bundle really allows us to talk about a bundle which has the fibers of the original bundles times the fiber of the other bundle, but at the same point. And we will be mostly interested in the Whitney sum of the tangent bundle with itself, and just writing it down as a set. So this is the set of all tangent spaces TLP at M times TP at M. Yeah, so this is the tangent bundle of M Whitney sum with the tangent bundle of M. And here We see now that on the fibers of this bundle, we can define our Riemannian metric. So what the Riemannian metric will do, it will assign to each one of these fibers a unique choice of not a unique choice, a choice of inner product, and we can then use the smooth structure of this bundle to explain what we mean by that the metric should be a smooth choice. Before we go there, let me make two comments. So for those of you who have seen Riemannian geometry in finite dimensions, there are several equivalent ways in finite dimensions to explain smoothness. We will always use the Whitney sum because this always exists and can always be defined for an arbitrary infinite dimensional manifold. In finite dimensions, one very popular choice is to say it's a smooth choice if whenever I compose it with two arbitrary vector fields, I get a smooth map. So basically, smoothness in the finite dimensional case is often defined by testing it against the smoothness of a against smooth vector fields. And in infinite dimensions, we cannot do that. The reason for that is that that on an arbitrary infinite dimension manifold, it's not clear that we can even construct vector fields which pass through a given point of the tangent bundle. The reason for this is that in general, we do not have bump functions available. So there are spaces which don't have bump functions, so we cannot build cu or custom build vector fields which go through a prescribed element. So testing smoothness in the infinite dimension setting is si simply in general not feasible using vector fields. We really need the Whitney sum here. Okay. Anyway, before we return to the setting of to the setting of Riemannian metrics, I want to prove the following theorem, which we will really need later on when we are dealing with these manifolds of mappings and Riemannian metrics. So let's take a step back and prove something about the Whitney sum. And the statement is recorded here in C3.4. So if we have a compact manifold, an MM manifold, which admits a local addition, then okay, obviously we can form the Whitney sum of the tangent bundles of our manifolds of mapping. So we know that C infinity functions from K to M, they form a manifold. We can form the tangent bundle of this manifold. And so we have two bundles sitting over the manifold C infinity KM. And we can form their Whitney sum. And the statement is then this Whitney sum is isomorphic to the Whitney sum of the C infinity functions from K with values in Tm with itself. This shouldn't be a surprise because we proved that if we have a compact manifold and a manifold which admits a local addition, then this space here is isomorphic to the C infinity functions from K to Tm. Yeah, so we basically just applied the isomorphism to both components of the Whitney sum, and this Whitney sum commutes with isomorphism, so that's not a problem. So the real statement we have here is that it's the second isomorphism we have, so that the Whitney sum actually, if I have the Whitney sum of C infinity functions with values in this bundle plus the Whitney sum with C infinity functions with values in the TM bundle, then this is isomorphic to the C infinity function with values in the Whitney sum. Okay, so let's just take a quick look at how we prove this. So proof of C3.4. So what we want to be seeing is TC infinity KM plus T C infinity KM is isomorphic to C infinity K TM Whitney sum with TM. Okay, so note first, C infinity KM, So this was compact. This has local addition. So is a canonical manifold. And as you might have guessed, we are exploiting again the canonical manifold stuff. So, however, also, if I look at this one, C infinity K with values in Tm, if M has local addition, then we have this abstract result that also the tangent bundle of M has local addition. So this is also a canonical manifold. Okay, since the Whitney sum. Commutes with isomorphisms. We derive from C infinity KM is isomorphic to C infinity KTM that T C infinity K M plus the same guy again. This is isomorphic to C infinity K T M plus C infinity K T M. Okay. And okay, now we need a little bit more background knowledge. So since the Whitney sum is constructed as a pullback bundle, this shows that C infinity KTM, I mean, perhaps I shouldn't have written this shows. This is basically the construction. How do you construct the manifold structure on a pullback bundle? So you realize this guy, so the Whitney sum is the pullback we use an upper star for this one. So this is the pullback of the direct product bundle. And by construction, the construction is as follows. So you pull this thing back, and then you realize the pullback as a split submanifold of, so this is the base manifold of the base manifold times C infinity K TM times C infinity K TM. Right. So this is a this guy is a split submanifold. So here the inclusion is actually as a split submanifold. Okay. And now we know. So the first piece here is a canonical manifold. This piece is a canonical manifold, and this piece is a canonical manifold. And we have this nice property of canonical manifolds that they play nicely with direct products. So we see that the whole guy here, this is isomorphic as a canonical manifold to the C infinity functions from K with values in M times TM times TM. Okay. And it's easy to see that the above diffeomorphism turns C infinity K TM, the Whitney sum, so this split submanifold into the set C infinity K TM plus TM. right? So, okay. So now we have, this is an easy computation. So if you don't believe me, I invite you to just do it and see, to just look at what is this identification here as a formula. So this identification of the stuff I underscored the red with this one. And you will immediately see that that elements which lie in the Whitney sum get mapped by the diffeomorphism into the C infinity function, which take values in the Whitney sum. Okay, now we know that this is a subset of the C infinity functions from K M times T M times T M, and so we know that. The guy upstairs, this one, is a submanifold. And we have mapped it diffeomorphically. So we have a diffeomorphism of an ambient manifold, mapping this ambient manifold, the one in red upstairs here, to the manifold in green here. So we have this diffeomorphism which maps the yellow split submanifold onto this other set. For the other set, we don't necessarily know that it is a manifold yet. However, small fact, you will prove this as an exercise. If N in M is a split submanifold, and phi from M to L is a diffeo, then phi of N is a split submanifold. Of L. So we see that C infinity K T M plus C infinity K T M. This is isomorphic to C infinity K T M plus T M. And so S split submanifolds. I'm not writing down the ambient manifolds. Those were the ones in red and green from above. Okay. Now you might worry a little bit because, I just used this sheep trick. I had this ambient diffeomorphism and it took me to the right set, and then the right set miraculously is a submanifold. What if the C infinity function with values in the Whitney sum are already a submanifold? Do we get a new structure, a new submanifold structure on the C infinity functions with values in the Whitney sum? And the answer is no. If you already know that the C infinity functions are a submanifold, then this submanifold structure is uniquely determined and does not change by the diffeo. Why is that? Because we know that this ambient space here, this is a canonical manifold. So if we, the other source why this could be a split submanifold, the one in, this one here. So the constructions we know is basically we could single out a local addition on the Whitney sum and use this to build a manifold structure which would then turn out with some work to be a submanifold of the guy on the right hand side. However, we do this. This is also a canonical manifold. Because we have this nice property, if this is a submanifold, the statement in chapter 2 was, if we have a canonical manifold of mappings, and we have another manifold of mappings which turns out to be a submanifold of this canonical manifold of mappings, where the target of this manifold of mappings, so in this case the target is the Whitney sum, Is a submanifold of this one, then automatically the manifold structure on the submanifold is also a canonical manifold structure. Okay, and so this shows that in both cases, in any way we could construct a submanifold structure on the left-hand side, we would always get a canonical submanifold. And this is also true for the submanifold structure induced by the diffeomorphism. By this, which diffeomorphism do I mean? I mean this diffeomorphism downstairs here. Okay. So in any way I can build a submanifold structure, I always get a canonical manifold structure, and we know that canonical manifold structures are up to diffeomorphism unique, right? So when this was not necessary to get the statement. So the statement we were after is that the Whitney sum of these tangent of these manifolds of mappings with values in the tangent bundle actually is isomorphic to the C infinity function of values in the Whitney sum. We will use this later. So this is not this is now not directly related to the question about Riemannian metrics. But since we have to discuss Whitney sums before that, I wanted to show you this proof before, because on one hand it's nice to remember stuff on these manifolds of mappings which we will be encountering, and then on the other hand we will use this result which is now in the strangely colored little box later on, to study the L2 metric. Okay, we'll get to what the L2 metric is in a while. But let's now go to finally to our definition. So 4.1.1 definition. So first of all, let M be a manifold modeled on a locally convex space E, a weak Riemannian metric let's call it G is a smooth map . So we take a smooth map from the Whitney sum of the tangent bundle of the manifold with itself, taking values in the reals. And so if I take a vector sitting at x and a vector sitting at x, I send them to gx, vx, wx. So the G gets an index. And so I have basically for every one of these mapping spaces, I have a I have such a mapping GX, and of course we want to require some things. So GX, this is by definition G restricted to the tangent space at X times the tangent space at X, is symmetric and bilinear for all x and m. Second property, gx of vv is greater or equal than zero for all v in txm, with gx vv equal to zero if and only if v is equal to zero. So this just means that we get symmetric, bilinear, and positive definite form on each tangent space, or in other words, we get an inner product on each tangent space. So this is our choice of inner products, where the smoothness information is now hidden inside of the smoothness of this Whitney sum. Right, so the Whitney sum controls the smoothness, And so if a weak Riemannian metric satisfies in addition the following condition. So the topology of the inner product space Tx M Gx coincides with the topology of Txm as a subspace of the tangent bundle, and this should hold for all x in M. We say that G is a strong Riemannian metric. Okay, and a manifold with a weak or strong Riemannian metric is called weak or strong Riemannian manifold. Okay. Right. Before we see,
Alexander, sorry, yes? Once again, the strong Riemannian, it is the same as Riemannian or not?
In finite dimensions, yes. Yeah, so
but in finite dimensions, weak is also the same as strong. There is
yes. So in okay, let's be, okay. Let's not do examples first. Let's talk a little bit about this. If you know finite dimensional Riemannian geometry, in finite dimensions, every weak Riemannian metric is already a strong Riemannian metric. So in finite dimensions, this distinction does not exist, because in finite dimensions you have no choice. So it's always strong. And this is because of the equivalence of norms, basically, in finite dimensions, right? So what you see is if you have an inner product here, and the inner product should be, I mean, this basically what the if you what the smoothness condition here on the tangent bundle enforces is that the inner products I've specified are continuous with respect to the topology on the tangent spaces. Right, and if you have in finite dimensions a continuous inner product, this will always give you a give you the same topology as the original topology. So in finite dimensions, this would just be called a Riemannian metric. But in infinite dimensions, we will soon see some examples where this is not where it's not true that. That we have that we will always get strong Riemannian metrics, and more often than not, the most interesting Riemannian metrics turn out to be the weak ones, not the strong ones. Okay.
I'm sorry for bothering, since I want to understand sure. The subtlety of this stuff. So essentially, the weak or strong is differ by the metric topology from the original topology.
Yes.
Is it true?
That too. I mean, perhaps there's also a good point to turn to yes. So, however, this is the condition here on the tangent spaces, right? We have here. So in case you have not seen Riemannian metrics, I mean, Irina knows this, of course, all, but when I first learned Riemannian metrics, this was a source of confusion, at least to me. You have this thing which is called a Riemannian metric. And we will soon see that this induces something like a metric on the manifold. However, by definition, this Riemannian metric is a choice of inner products. This doesn't...
Alexander, let's call about the distance function and the metric.
Okay, yeah, okay. Perhaps that's prudent, right? Okay, so you're right. You're right. So this does not... Well, I mean, we will soon see that this also induces something like a distance function. And I'm a little bit loath of calling it a distance function. I mean, we will use this name dist for distance later on, but we will see that that there are weak Riemannian metrics for which this distance function fails to be a distance in the usual mathematical sense of the word distance in a spectacular way. Yeah, so we'll see some examples of this later. But for the Riemannian metric is just a choice of inner products, so it doesn't immediately, I mean, there's a canonical way of getting a distance function, but it's not immediately giving you one. So the metric here is a choice of inner products. And the distinction is purely a topological on the tangent spaces. So is the topology induced by the inner product the same as the original topology on the tangent space? In general, we will soon encounter some examples where this is not the case, and at least for these manifolds of mappings we are fond of studying, since we are studying smooth mappings, so it will turn out that the smooth mappings never can have a strong Riemannian metric. Whenever you define on, say, spaces of mappings of smooth mappings, Riemannian metric, then this is automatically weak. Okay, let me because we are sort of a little bit in technicalities here. Let's make a general assumption for all which is coming today, tomorrow, and for the whole chapter. So my general assumption will be that the model spaces of my manifolds are from now on all, let's say, at least Mackey complete. Or if you want, you can even take stronger completeness conditions. So we know that this Mackey completeness was quite weak, right? So it's weaker than sequential completeness. So why do I want to assume this? It won't be very upfront in what I'm writing down, but we want to be able to be to compute some integrals. There are, at least in some of the proofs, some hidden convergence arguments. We will be citing some literature later on. And for some of these convergence arguments, you basically want to be sure that a certain amount, let's say, of Cauchy sequences or such things, that they actually converge in your space. So while we did never need any completeness conditions for the calculus we were introducing, so for Bastiani calculus and also for the Lie groups, this was apart from the piece about regular Lie groups, was not very essential. Here, some of the arguments we want to be doing are based on completeness properties of the space. And while Mackey completeness is very weak, note that in normed and inner product spaces, this already implies completeness. So if from now on normed spaces or inner product spaces are appearing, they will all be Banach and Hilbert spaces. The proof of this fact that this already formed in a product space is, I mean, Mackey completeness is quite weak, but that it implies already completeness, this is a non-trivial proof, right? And I think this should be recorded in the book by McCriegel and Michaud on the convenient calculus, because you basically have to show that everything you can approximate with usual Cauchy sequences, you can approximate with Mackey Cauchy sequences, and there's work to be done. Yeah, so this is not straightforward. Anyway, let's. So we have this general assumption. So basically, from now on, I will assume that my spaces are suitably complete. So in case you're wondering whether something converges, if it's an abstract convergence argument building on something like Picard iteration or Cauchy sequences, we will basically assume that the sequences we need for this converge in our space. Okay, but let's do some cheap examples for these Riemannian metrics. So if H with an inner product is a Hilbert space, then we have, okay, so what is the tangent bundle of a Hilbert space? It's a Hilbert space times a Hilbert space. What is the Whitney sum of the tangent bundle of the Hilbert space with itself? So this is actually, we are collecting all the fibers which are sitting over the same point. Or in other words, we have here the base point, collect all the base point times fiber at the base point times fiber at the base point. So, or in other words, I could write h to the third power or something like that. So this is the Whitney sum of the tangent bundle of h. Note that th times th would be isomorphic to h to the fourth power. So we are saving one base point. And we can define g from th plus th, well, this is h to the third, with values in the reals. And what we do is we take base point xy, and we just send it to the inner product of x and y. So this is constant in the base point and obviously smooth. Gives you on every tangent space a positive definite inner form. So this is, so therefore h with this g is a strong Riemannian manifold. Okay, so well, I mean, this is, of course, a cheap example. This is like telling you that an example for a Riemannian manifold is a Euclidean space. It's now that just we are allowing infinite dimensional spaces here. Let's do something more interesting. So let again, okay, first example, another example. Let H with an inner product, again, be a Hilbert space. And then we can, of course, look at the locally convex space of all smooth functions from 0, 1 with values in H. So we have proven before that this is a locally convex space with respect to the compact open C infinity topology. Okay. And one can prove that it is a Fréchet space. So that means it's a complete metrizable space, but it's not a Banach space and it's not a Hilbert space. So we've seen an argument why it can't be a Hilbert Banach space before. And what we then define the L2 inner product. So when we take two functions, the L2 inner product is by definition, you integrate from 0 to 1 the function values and then you bracket them. So this is obviously bilinear on the C infinity functions from 0, 1 to h. And so, and it is not hard to prove, and this is again an exercise, that the L2 thing is continuous. And we know that a continuous bilinear map is smooth. And now we do the usual yada yada. We know that T of C infinity from 0, 1 to H, this is just the same as C infinity from 0, 1 to H times itself. Because it's a locally convex space, this formula is always true. We can just identify again H times H. And so we have C infinity from 0, 1 to TH. I'm a bit careful with this identification. Why did we do this in a, I mean, if we knew that it was a canonical manifold, which you can prove, but we haven't done this in the lecture because, again, sort of, I mean, it's nice to do everything on intervals, but formally speaking, we have our nice results only for manifolds which don't have a boundary. And here we have the two boundary points, 0 and 1. So I need to climb a little bit more. Obviously, the proofs don't change, but we haven't formally treated manifolds with boundary. So this leads basically to an isomorphism, this observation, TC infinity from 0, 1, H, direct a Whitney sum with itself. So there we can identify this as the C infinity functions from 0, 1 to h to the third, right? As in the last example. So and if we have let's say we have two functions, fc and gc, in tc, C infinity from 0, 1 to h. Gets identified with a triplet. So C, F, and G. So we can define a weak Riemannian metric as follows. So GL2 from TC infinity 0, 1, oops, values in H plus, well, again, itself. So we send FC GC. We want to go into the reals, and we are just sending everything to the L2 product of F and G. Okay, and so exercise here is check the details. So basically, you need to check continuity of this L2 function. Okay, so this metric is also called this metric or the weak Riemannian metric GL is called L2 metric. I mean, for obvious reasons, because we're integrating in the L2 sense. So this is the L2 metric, and note that it is not a strong Riemannian metric. Why is that? if we look at the inner product introduced by the L2 metric, and we look at the topology, what this would be, this would induce the topology on C infinity from 0 on to H. So this is the tangent space. C infinity from 0, 1 to H. So this is the tangent space. And since GL2 induces the subspace topology of the inclusion, so we include the C infinity function into the L2 function. So all square integrable functions from 0, 1, which take values in our Hilbert space H. And where this is the Hilbert space of square integrable functions with the L2 topology. Right, and this is a different topology. This does not coincide with the compact open C infinity topology. Okay, and so this is the first example of a weak Riemannian metric. Okay, right. Let's have a look at a consequence of having a weak Riemannian metric and not a strong one. And this is now going mostly towards people who know finite dimensional Riemannian geometry, because they are most certainly used to the following. So there's this raising and lowering index stuff. So, okay, what does it mean? So if, let's say we have a weak Riemannian, not weak Riemannian geometry, weak Riemannian manifold. There is an injective linear map. And this is usually written as one of these musicals, so the flat isomorphism. So Tm goes to T star M. And by definition, this is, this should be the dual bundle. We had already this comment that dual bundles are tricky in infinite dimensions. So let me just write it down as a set. So those are the continuous linear mappings from the tangent spaces with the values in the reals. And what we are doing, if I have something here in the tangent space, let's say a V, I'm sending it to the linear functional where I put the V, let's say in the first component, and then I'm not evaluating here. So this is a continuous linear map from the tangent space at X, taking values in the reals, which just takes the inner product of V with whatever I'm feeding it. So this is an injective linear map if M is finite dimensional. Then the flat morphism is surjective by a dimension counting argument. Right, so I know that an injective linear map between an n-dimensional space to an n-dimensional between two n-dimensional spaces always is an isomorphism, right? And in infinite dimensions, this doesn't work. So, however, if G is a strong Riemannian metric, then the flat morphism, so this B, is an isomorphism by the Riesz representation theorem. Note that here again, this is one of the instances where completeness of the space is lurking, because Ries representation is using completeness of the inner product space we have here. So for a strong Riemannian metric, we know that we have an isomorphism, and the inverse of the flat morphism is denoted by sharp in these situations. So the pair flat and sharp are also known as the musical isomorphisms. In general, in our setting for weak Riemannian metrics, there's the flat will not be surjective. And this creates some problems, at least when one is used to tricks from finite dimensional geometry. So the nice thing about these musical isomorphisms is that they allow us a nice identification of vector fields with differential forms. And this is all extremely useful in finite dimensions. Unfortunately, in this generalized weak setting we are working in, on one hand, it's not true that the flat is an isomorphism, because surjectivity will fail in general. And then on the other hand, we already had this comment that dual spaces are, at least in the locally convex setting, a problem, right? Because this is part of the problem here. The dual spaces do not play nicely when we are going beyond the setting of Hilbert spaces. Okay, let me give you an example of how this fails to be surjective. The space of immersions. So I take the immersions from the sphere S1 into RD. This turns out to be an open set, subset of the C infinity functions from S1 with values in RD. This was an exercise in one of the earlier chapters. In chapter 2, we have shown that this is an open subset. So endow it with the invariant L2 metric, and this one will be defined by the following formula: at a base point C, HK, this is, we integrate over S1. H theta k theta, and then we are multiplying by the norm of by the norm of C dot at theta d theta. Okay. First comment, because I assume that there are at least some people who, in the audience, who have not seen this integral. So there will be more information on the integral tomorrow. I mean, this is relatively straightforward, because S1 is quite easy. So this should be an integral in the sense of integration on manifolds. But if you haven't seen it, then what you can do is, let's say we take the integral from 0 to 2 pi, and take the following parameterization here. So we're sending t to cosine of t sine of t. And then basically, so we call this mapping also theta with a little bit of abuse of notation. So the theta is, of course, supposed to be this integration parameter we have upstairs here. And you're just inserting the theta into the above formula and use the change of you use the substitution rule to make sense of the integral. And I'm cheating here because I'm not explaining to you how you integrate on a general manifold, but from the general theory it then follows that this actually makes sense and gives you sort of a well-defined integral on S1. We can define this. Why is this an invariant formulation of the L2 metric? In the original L2, we didn't have this additional term here, the one with the norm of the base point derivative, right? And the point here will be that if we are changing the base points of the by a diffeomorphism, or if we rotate on S1, then basically the integral will notice the rotation. And it turns out that this kills off all the diffeomorphisms on S1. So this is, it's basically invariant under the diffeomorphism action. Okay, anyway, we are not at this point discussing the invariance properties of this L2 metric. But let me just give you a hint, and then you work out why. Let's first recollect why this makes sense as a definition at all. So we know that the immersions from S1 with values in RD, that they are an open subset in the C infinity functions from S1 with values in RD. And since it's an open submanifold, this means if I am taking the tangent space here at some point, then this is just a copy of the base space. So we know that this guy is a vector space, or actually a locally convex space, right? And so I'm taking the tangent space at an open subset, and I get the whole space. So it actually makes sense to define this GC mapping here, because so the H will then, and the K, they will be elements again from going from S1 and taking values in RD. So I can actually take here the inner product of RD and compare these two things, and the formula makes sense. And what you will be working out is what is the Whitney bundle, the Whitney sum of the tangent bundles, and you will see that this is actually smooth. Okay, working in this identification. The musical morphism reduces to the map. So we have the flat thing, and we apply it to a vector H sitting at a base point C. So what we get then here is, so this would be, we would need G C H C dot. And we can identify this as the vector, recall that this one here is just, we take the inner product with the H C dot, and then we multiply it with C dot, right? And, or in other words, we can exploit the bilinearity. So this is just C dot multiplied with this H C, right? And then we have this inner product here in RD, pointwise. Okay, so in other words, we can identify what is the image here. So we want, in the end, we want to get something, so we need to get something in the dual space of S1 RD. So, dual space. This should be an element in the dual space. And what is this element? If we are just writing out what's the element, then the element should be C dot multiplied with this mapping HC, right? So this is now a smooth map. Inducing the linear functional this form, right? So we just need to remember this element here. Okay, why am I insisting that this is a smooth map? Why is this interesting? Because it's known that if I take the dual space of these functions, so from S1 with values in RD, what is the space? This is D prime, S1 to the dth power. So this is the space of RD valued distributions. On S1. So if you've seen distributions, you know now what I'm talking about. If you have not seen distributions, all of this is explained in the book by Taylor.
Alexander, distributions, yes. In a sense of generalized functions?
Yes, exactly.
I'm,
yes.
Sorry.
No, that's
a little bit.
Yeah, sure. No, this is a good question. Yes. So distribution in the sense of generalized functions. And so the point is that inside of these distributions, so the C infinity functions are sitting, of course, inside of the distribution space. I mean, distribution, if you want, in the sense of Schwartz. So perhaps that's so DS. So this is sitting inside of the space of distributions, but it's a proper subspace. So not every distribution is a smooth function. And this observation is the reason why I wanted to have this identification here, because we see that the image of the flat map consists only of smooth mappings in this identification of the dual space, and so what we get is, in fact, we get everything which is a smooth function on S1. So this is the image of the flat map, let's say, applied to TC immersions from S1 with values in RD. And we see that we get a proper subspace. So surjectivity fails here in this setting. On one hand, this shows you that we cannot have at most a weak Riemannian metric. I mean, there would have been easier ways to see this. This is a concrete example of where the flat map is not surjective in a perhaps naturally occurring space. Okay, I mean we will not ever need distributions in this course again. It's just because it's a very satisfying example. And if you don't know what a distribution is, just the takeaway message is the space on the right hand side is bigger, so the flat map is not surjective. Okay, let me make a short remark here. So if M admits a strong Riemannian metric, M is necessarily modeled on a Hilbert space. Right, because then the topology of the inner product space coincides with the topology of the tangent space, and the tangent space is, as a locally convex space, isomorphic to the model space due to the uniqueness of the topology on finite dimensional manifolds. And here is the remark which Irina already made. Every weak Riemannian metric on finite dimensional manifolds is already strong. So in finite dimensions, there's no distinction. That's why when you read a usual book about Riemannian geometry, then you will never see the weak, strong scale there, because this is something which is genuinely infinite dimensional. And this statement is already false on Hilbert spaces. And we'll see an example in the next lecture. So while if it's a strong Riemannian metric, the model space needs to be Hilbert. If you have a Riemannian metric on a manifold modeled on a Hilbert space, you still cannot be sure that the resulting metric will be strong. Okay, let me give you a few more examples. So again, we fix a Hilbert space. Then we saw that the Hilbert sphere, those are all the x and h such that the norm of x is equal to 1. So we know already that this is a submanifold, and it turns out to be a strong Riemannian manifold with respect to the induced metric. So gx vw is defined as, well, again, the inner product of v and w, where we have identified. So what is, again, the tangent space at the Hilbert sphere? We have already computed this. Those are all the v in h such that v inner product with x is equal to 0, or in other words, it's the orthogonal complement of x. Okay, so this is the last example I wanted to give in this section. Well, this concludes the first overview of, or some interesting examples for weak Riemannian metrics and this weak strong characterizations. We haven't seen so much. This will be more prevalent in the next chapters, of what the distinction between weak and strong really means. Okay.